Hello dear students, welcome to the lecture 10 of Introduction to Programming 2 with C# course, as known as also Advanced Programming. So we will continue from where we have left in the previous lecture. Let's start with cloning our code as usual. Okay, if you are remembering, we were having a problem with a certain drug, and I hope that you have found it. Meanwhile, watching our video in the previous lecture, so I will start with showing you where the error is, and then we will add search features to our application. Okay, so we were having a problem with a certain drug, and it was digoxin 0.125 milligram. And why do you think we are having that drug problem as a problem? Okay, I have used DBugs to capture that error, but I think there is another way. I already know the error because I have figured it out quickly, but I will also try to explain you in another way. So every question is getting executed in our database, every query, and we can capture them with SQL Server Profiler. So since we don't have any problem in our source code, the error must relate to the database side. Therefore, let's try to capture that error and see what it is. Okay, I am checking standard SQL running. Okay, and let's start our software to see what kind of query is causing an error. Okay. Okay, the software is still getting loaded. Okay. First we have to log in and let's check our users table. Okay, let's log in as a doctor. Okay, and I will click load data into database and watch the error. Okay, so these queries were executed. You see the executed query is select T drug. Let's see what kind of result it is returning. Okay, so the executed query returns this, and then let's continue. Okay, before the error happened, error happening, let's check the which query were executed and the error itself. Okay, so no, is this the query? Okay, binary data. Okay, and let's continue. Okay, so this is the next query. And This looks like related to database itself. And these are select queries. Select, select. Is there any insert query? No. Okay, drug ID, TB address, DBO. No other parameters. And here, drug ID. Here. No. Here. It must be somewhere else, but okay, here. So it is here, and you see this is the query executed, and then let's see if there is a message that shows the query didn't execute. PCR RPC completed. Okay, this is the insert query and this has resulted an error. Yeah, I have found it. Okay, I see now. So this is the application name, UC Core Microsoft SQL Client Data Provider, and others are Microsoft Server Management Studio. So we should have checked this from the beginning. I just figured it out. And this is the one that our software executed. So let's execute this in SQL Server Management Studio and see what happens. Okay, it says cannot insert duplicate K. And why do you think it is duplicate? Because there is something here that catches my eye, and I am hoping that it also catches yours. This is 0.125 milligram. However, the value here is 0.13. Why do you think? Because in our drugs table, we did set the decimal precision as 2. We have to set it at least 3 because in our database here, it appears that there is also 3 precision having milligram. I don't know if there is also 4 precision milligram. So to be sure, you can set it as 4 precision as well. So let's change it to 4 precision. And let's update our database classes. I mean the PMS classes with using EFI Power Tools. Okay, PMS is selected, Patient Management System. Okay. Okay, precision is increased it to 4. We can also see that. Let me show you. Here you see 10 over 4. Now we should not get that error. And of course, insert more drugs into our table. Okay. Let's see how the count increases. Okay, still same. So many duplicate drugs there are, obviously. Or in the code we have an error. Let's check our code. It was inside, I think, logged in operations. And where is the convert decimal? Here, no. Code looks fine. Okay, you see every drug is almost duplicate. So they are not getting inserted. We still have only inserted one drug. Oh, however, there are over 200,000 drugs. But you see they are all duplicate. What value changes? The value changes are like this. I don't know what they mean. Okay, it is now 3. Let's check from database and see if it is increased. Yes, it is increased by 2 as expected. Okay, we have fixed the error. We don't need to wait all of them to be loaded into database. However, it is working pretty fast also because we are using local cache. And yeah, that's it. Now we have fixed the error. Okay, now time to add a search feature as well. You see, in your application, I am also expecting you to have in your homework, in your semester project, search feature as well. Search books or such. Okay. To be able to search, let's add a text box. Okay, and let's say tell user to enter search words. Okay, search and add a button for search. Okay, name BTN search. Okay, search drug right name. Okay, so this will search by name and okay, it looks fine. Let's add a click event and this click event will just refresh data grid. I will also add enter event to for this, so let's also edit C sharp top enter click event. Let's say top item. I think the way will be capturing key down events. So yeah, let's select our form here and let's get key down events. I wonder if this is possible with top item key down. So it will be specific to this one, I'm hoping. So yes, there is key down. Okay, and it is top drugs key down. It is sender. I see. So it is not bound to a specific item. It looks regular, but I'm not sure. So here we need to check which key is sent. Okay, it is like this. If e key data key enter, but there is no key data for key events. K character maybe. E dot key. Yeah, maybe like this. Equal to key dot enter. Okay, and now we are going to simulate this. Okay, so enter will also do the refresh. Great, but I don't want this to be clicked in other panels, so let's see if we can also achieve that. So this should be bound to enter event only in drugs panel. Okay, drugs tab. In other panels, when I click enter, okay, nothing happens. And nothing happens here. Normally, we should bind it to login, but we didn't do it yet. And I will also do that for you. So when I hit enter, nothing happens. Let's also bind it. Okay, in the login panel here, let's add the event key down where it is. Here. Okay, and this will just call login click. Where it is? It is here. And let's also add a bind to register here. Top control selected. Yeah, and there is key down event. Okay, so you see in the XML file, we are getting a key down event like here. So it should be specific to this tab only, not other tabs. And this will just call the register. Actually, I wonder if I can just type the register event. So what I mean is, on here, let's go to the login. Where it is? Oh. Can I just make it like this? And would it work? So it will reduce our code behind code. I will trigger a login button directly with enter. Let's see. I will just click enter. Okay. Oh, I have to put breakpoint here. Okay, it is working. So we don't even need this extra unnecessary code. Yeah. With enter, I will just. Oh, but this would. No, no, no. We don't. We can't make it like this. Yes. We have to have a separate method because this would call at every key down. However, I need to call it only if it is enter key. Okay. Like this, and this will be okay. We don't have this top control key down. Okay. Yeah, we don't need a key down in top control. You see, you should avoid every kind of unnecessary code. Okay, so this is the register key down. And in the register, this is the method that we are going to call. Okay. Okay, now it should work. Let's try. Okay, now I will click enter. Yes, it is working. Error, please select your user rank role first. Let's enter. Yes, an error occurred. Okay, so the test Gmail exists. Okay, registered and logged in. However, since we don't have patient top yet, it is still here. Let's log out. And let's try enter. Okay, it doesn't work for login top yet. So top login, we didn't add it to here. This is top register. And this is top login and we have key down. And let's see if it is firing. No, register fires, but login is not. Why it is not firing? Okay, so this is top item, key down fires. But login top. Okay, now fires. Interesting. It does fire. One second. Okay. When I hit enter like this, it fires. But if I click somewhere else and click, it doesn't fire. I have to have either here or inside here. So in here, when I click the empty area, it doesn't fire. The event is not firing. So I have to, my cursor either have to be here or on here. I think I can fix that as well. So instead of writing For each one, what I'm going to do is I'm going to catch all click events. Okay. So I click main window, lecture window, and here I'm generating a main window key down. And if the key is entered, what I'm going to do is I'm going to use switch case. And no, I can't use the switch. I have to use if and else. If. Okay, so which tabs do we have? We have tab drugs is selected. We are going to call in the tab drugs, we are going to call refresh. Okay. Then if tab login selected, we are going to call login like this. And if tab register is selected, we are going to call this. So it will also reduce our number of methods. So it is even better, I think. And then let's remove the key down events here, since we have deleted their methods. Okay, and let's run the application. I will click somewhere empty and enter. Yes, it is working. Let's pick this. I am clicking somewhere empty place. Enter. Yes, working. Okay, let's log out. I'm clicking somewhere empty. Enter. No, it is still not working. Interesting. So if I make a change like this, not working. I see the reason. You see, I am not able to click an empty space if this tab is manually selected. But when it's automatically selected, it is not seeing as this tab is selected. Therefore, when it is manually selected, it is working. However, if it's automatically selected, it is not. So there is no problem. It is working as expected. And let's log in. Enter. Nice. Let's go to drug tabs. And let's click enter. Yes, it has refreshed. Okay, so our key event is working now. By the way, the enter is bound to this one. I could bind it to this or this, and this will also still work for manual clicking. Now I need to type search. Okay, so for this text box, I wonder if they have added placeholder features. C# text box placeholder. BPF. Let's see if they have added it. There weren't these previously, but maybe it has come. No. Looks like still there is not a easier way. Okay, however there is XAML way which has defining alignment and other things. So it has text block, and text block is being the code. I think I will use this so you can also learn it. In the top drugs. Okay, let's go to text box. So inside this text, under this text box, let's edit. Okay, it is put here. So these will have name of oh, we still don't have a name, so it is fine. Let's move this to here. Oh, it is simply a text box. And placeholder is like this inside here, I think. Okay. Yes, it is looking fine. And let's add a name as txt search term. Search by drug name. Okay. And let's run the application to see. So you see, someone else has already asked our question exactly as we wanted. This is why searching is really important. Some of your friends asked me what to do that he can't proceed. The way is looking for answers. However, I can't see the placeholder. Interesting. Why? Okay, there is text box. Enter search term here. And type target type text block. Binding element. Oh, you see there is element name. So it is binded to an element. Since we have changed the text box name, we have to change it. Bind element name here as well. You see here element name. Now it should work. Okay. Now visible, and when I click it should, when I click something, yes, it is getting cleared. It is exactly as working we wanted. Let's click enter. Okay. Now it is time to implement our search feature. Search by a drug name. Okay. Let's also resize this a little bit to smaller size. Like this. Let's put it to center. Okay. So in our refresh method here, we are going to also include the name. And how we are going to do that? Okay, so let's see how we are going to do that. There is local binding list, and okay, so this is the way we are loading. And we need to add an extension to search. Okay. And how can we do it? We need to add something like where. Okay. And pr.pr like this. pr.drug name like. And how can we do it as perhaps GG? Okay, so is this working? No. Let's look how it is possible with entity framework. Like operator in entity framework. How do we do it? Oh, I see. It is like query. Yeah, this is what we need. So contains. Okay. And here we are going to add a string. So this is empty character, so everything should have that. And let's see if this is working. Let's add to the default. Or let's add to the everything here. As if it is working, I have an idea. So this is sort by DOS. Okay, and this will be an addition like this. This. So first it will order. I think we need to add first where query. That would be more logical than sort. Yeah, like this. Okay. I don't know if this will work, but let's see. Because this is an empty string, and I don't know if it will work or not. However, this can also cause some performance issue. That's okay, so it is working, nice. So what we are going to do is, okay, string sr search term will be like this. Can we tell contains null? I wonder that. Okay, it still looks like working. I'm not sure. Let's try this too. Maybe this can optimize database better. Oh, null is not working. Let's see what kind of query it is generating. I also wondered that. So let's open SQL Server Provider. And let's sort like this. Okay, so it is executing. Okay, it's saying like null. Okay, and therefore it is basically checking if drug name is null or not, and therefore it is not working. So we will make it like this, and if txt, by the way, it will come from these dots or main. Did we assign it to something? Global methods main, yeah. Actually, bigger than zero. We will assign it to this. Okay. And then here. Okay, let's make another search. So we are cascading. However, actually, if we don't have any drug name search, we shouldn't cascade it. We should have coded another case scenario and add this where only if this is bigger. I wonder if that is possible. Yeah. Okay. And refresh. Okay, working. Okay. Let's see the query. So the query is okay, so it is like this. I think SQL Server would have optimization for this because when we search like this, okay, so it has or, yeah. And let's see how it is executed with execution plan. So it is doing in the cluster index scan. So it is scanning entire index, which is a big no-no because it would take a lot of time. So what we need to do is we need to compose an index as okay, let's open another instance to add an index. Entity name conditional var class. I wonder if this is possible. That would make our performance better. Okay, so we can define a query like this and then we can execute the query. Yeah, let's try this approach. So it is expecting a load, right? So what we are going to do is we won't call the load right away, and if we will add it like this. Okay. And then we will load we will call the load here. I'm not sure if this would work, but it should work, I believe. Yeah, let's try it. So let's remove var. I hope it works because it would be better performance. Okay. Let's remove this as well. Okay. So let's try. So here basically we are appending another predicate to our. But this is not like a query. I am not sure if this will work or not here. Okay, let's sort by those. Okay, not working. So, how do we set a query and execute it? So basically we are using a context, right? Okay, so it is asked here. No, this is not answer we are looking for. Okay. Okay, since we are using a local cage and binding it to a data grid, it looks like it is not possible. All of these calls you are seeing are just returning data. They are not bindable and editable a data grid. Therefore, they are not like we wanted. Okay, so it won't work like this. Yeah. Okay, let's return it to the older way. And here we will just put search term and we will add an index to optimize our database queries. I could write different switch and cases like default case and if it is bigger this case like let me show you if as our search term let's say if search term if it is null like this and else like this so if it is null it will simply It won't simply contain this. And if it is not null, it will contain this. So this is also another way to optimize your queries. However, it is getting more crowded, but you can optimize your code like this. Anyway, I will also add an index to improve performance. And how am I going to do that? So before the index, let's see our performance. Okay, here. And it shows that estimated number of rows to read is 3500. And estimated CPU cost and whatever there are. And now let's add an index to instead of doing index scan, index seek. Okay, what we want to do is never a scan. Scan means scanning entire index. What we want is seek. Okay, so here in TBL drugs indexes. And new index non-clustered. So with which value we are searching, the value we are searching is drug name. So it comes first, then we are sorting by the dose, then this comes first. Drug ID will be included by default, and this index is not unique. However, we can make it unique, I think. Drug name dose. We already have this as an index actually. Let's see. Oh, since we are doing a like query, it has to scan. Yeah, there is no other way for let's say query optimizer to do anything else. So it has to make a scan. And we already have drug name and drug dose, and therefore it is doing an entire table scan. Okay, so let's test our software and see if our search is working or not. Okay, let's refresh and let's search by this proxy pin or how it is. Okay, now we are able to see all proxy pin. I don't know how it is read. And then you see one ending with TA, one ending with CA. We can also, I think we can also sort by those discounting. Yes, it is working. Nice. Let's remove this. Enter. Let's look for a milk. Okay. Since our database is, I believe, case insensitive, it should bring this as well. So this is the milk, and they are sorted by the scanning. Also, we are displaying four digits here as a precision. So let's make it as name, the scanning, or ID, the scanning, a scanning, whatever you want. Yeah, it is working exactly as we wanted. All right. Okay, let's take the notes of so far, and before doing that, I will rename this to lecture 10. Okay. Okay, so and how to add searching feature to Entity framework context. Okay, how to capture key events application wide and okay, do actions based on selected tab. Okay, I think now what else there is? Okay. Text queries, yeah. Okay, and do we have anything else? Let's think. Key down events or key press. Okay, so now we have searching, filtering, editing, and whatever we want. And after login, I will make application to automatically go to drugs tab if it is a doctor. So let's also add that. And it will be inside in our login operations. And you see we are setting logged in user. Okay, before doing that, if okay, logged user and user type is equal to, so what was the user type? The user type is set here. And medical doctor is 2. We will set top drug selected as true. Okay. So let's log in. You see, you should try to make application as easy as possible to be used by your clients or users. This should be your aim in every case. Okay, and now it is working. Okay, so what other screen we might need to have? We can have prescriptions, treatments, and other things according to our needs. However, I don't think so we need to code those screens because they will be similar. Our aim here is the learning as much as necessary features possible. So today I will show you also what is and how it is used yield return. Okay, so what is yield return and how it is used? So let's get an idea about what is yield return. Of course, if you have questions, ask me through Discord so I can answer your question or explain more things in the next lecture video. Okay, don't forget that. Okay, so understanding yield return in C sharp.
Once you understand having yield return in C# code, you will not help wondering what a return form or a special mechanism to handle it is. In the article below, we will learn some programming techniques that revolve around C# yield return keywords. Quote from MSDN: the yield keyword signals to the compiler that the method in which it appears is an iterator block. The compiler generates a class to implement the behavior that is expressed in the iterator block. In the iterator block, the yield keyword is used together with the return keyword to provide a value to the enumerator object. This is the value that is returned, for example, in each loop of a for each statement. The yield keyword is also used with break to signal the end of iteration.
Okay, so let's continue.
Iteration. 1. Method of operation of yield when combined with the return mechanism allowing creation. The function returns a value that handles certain information in the loop and puts an end to certain conditions before it. This is contrary to the case of a normal return. I get a return value of the function that will return and finish the function at that point. But here, the function is to call back in the loop containing the yield return function that just ended. From here we can imagine an action that is rather abstract, but can be useful in some cases, to help keep code concise and tight. 2. Some requirements for the use of yield return: do not put yield in an unsafe block. Do not use ref or out keywords with the parameters of the method, operator or accessor, getter slash setter. Yield return can only be placed in the try block if it is followed by a finally block. Yield break can be put in the try block and catch, but not placed in the finally block. Do not use yield of the anonymous method. 3. An example of using yield return. To use yield return, you just need to create a method with a return type that is an IEnumerable, arrays and collections in. Net implements IEnumerable interface with a loop and use yield return to return a value to set in the loop body. Some examples are of a function with two arguments, int start, int number, made in even numbers starting from the starting number. The following is the code written in the usual way, transmitted to the and returns the result as an array, and then use one array to receive the value returned. Instead, we can use a yield return to make the code simpler, quick operation, reducing operating costs through other intermediaries, easy error checking code in the case of large volume.
Okay, so there are some codes, so let's make our example from beginning and it will make us understand better. I am going to compose an additional CMD project, command line project. So we will do example of yield return on there and understand it better. Okay, I'm selecting console application. It is .NET Core. Next, so this will be, let's name it as let's select the folder lectures and lecture 10 CMD. I will name it as like this. Next. You see .NET 5 current, latest, .NET Core. Okay, so the function here is basically doing addition. Let's see what does this do. There is an array which has length 10, and there is a function which adds start and other things. Let's write it. So let's write our array as int a. Yeah. Integer array a equal to new integer array 10, the size. Then we have a function which is like this, public static integer array, my function, whatever the name, method. So this method is taking start and number and basically what it is doing is it is initializing a new temporary array like this. Okay, integer with 10. Where does this 10 come from? The 10 is coming from top. Oh, it is declaring it numbers, not 10. And with 4, starting from 0 to number, it is assigning array value like this. I equal to start and multiply with oh plus with 2 and multiply with I, and then it will return the array. Okay, and then we are going to write line. Yeah, I see. So let's assign a equal my method and 2 to 10, and then we can do a for each, I think, with array and console write line item. Okay, let's see what does this print. So this is a very basic function. It will print numbers assigning to the array. Okay, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, and 20. Okay. Because it is adding 0 to start is from 2, 2 plus 0, and then 2 plus 2, then 2 plus 4, 2 plus okay, 6 and so. So now instead of this, we are going to use yield return. Okay, how can we do that? The yield return returns a value at each enumeration. Okay, so basically we will modify this code to be like for each, we are going to have another method. So this method will return an integer. And actually it is supposed to return, it is supposed to return enumerator as well. And this will be method yield. Okay, so basically we, instead of an array here, we will have something like this yield return. Okay, and this is supposed to return, okay, it says so. This is not an iterator type. Let's make it like integers. Okay, this is not an enumerator type as well. I see. So it just returns I enumerable, not a any type. Okay, I had to add system collections. Okay, so instead of assigning it like this, now what I need to do is simply call 4 to 10 and console another 4 to 10, yeah, for each, and I will call yield return. And it will take 2 and 10. And then console write line item. So you see how the code becomes much simpler and easier. So let's put a breakpoint here as well. And okay, here as well. Okay, let's execute it. Step over and see on the screen 2. 2 is written. Execute. Oh, this is the. I don't know why this error happens, but when you are doing on my computer, actually, it happens. When I doing iteration with debug, it happens. So you see, it is printing the same. However, this is not directly returning from the method. For each loop, it returns a value and continue looping. So this value comes here, and then we use it like this, there, here. Okay. So this is what is yield return. If you make another example yourself, you can understand it better. I am sure of it. It can be very useful in cases. So this is it. I think it is much better to use, easier to understand, probably more effective. Now we are rid of this array definition here or array definition here. And yes. Okay, so which topic we should continue? Let me think a bit. Okay, let's continue working with multi-threading a bit more, understand it better. So after here, I'm going to clear the screen. Okay, command console dot clear. Okay, so with multi-threading, there is a racing condition. Okay, therefore, to be able to use multi-threading efficiently, you have to synchronize between threads. What does that mean? Let me show you. So let's assume that I have a double number. Double is not atomic, therefore it should be fine. Example, DBL count. Okay. And assume that I have a method like this, void increase number. And what does this do is simply in a loop, let's say up to 10,000, it will increase counter by 1. So this would get us to, let's make it like this. Yeah, okay. This will let us, by the way, this also have to be static. Okay. So this will get us 10,000, right? And if I call this number 2 times, what would happen? Like this and like this. It would become 20,000, right? So let's make it. And console write line. Okay, expected value is 20,000. The value we got is okay, and the account to string and 0. Okay, let's see if it is displayed like that. Okay, so the expected value is 20,000 and the value we got is 20,000. Now what happens if I call these numbers simultaneously? How can I do that? I can do that with task.factory. And to be able to use that, I need to add a reference as threading tasks. Start name. Okay. So it is like this. I will start two separate tasks here, like this, and copy paste like this. I can even start multiple tasks. Let's start four tasks actually, like this. Okay, so what would be the expected value right now? The expected value would be 60,000, right? And let's see which value we are going to have. By the way, this will use four cores at the same time. So I am expecting to get full CPU. Okay. However, the value we got is 50,000. Why? We got exactly as 10K lesser. So let's see when we comment this and make it like this. You see, we are getting 60,000. However, when we start tasks, it is getting 50,000. It may be even lower than that as well, or different. So basically, a race is happening. Let's start without debugging. You see, we got 30,000 this time. So same threads, or actually let's say different threads, try to increase that number at the same time. And they got a race condition. What was it? Called data race multi-threading, if I remember correctly. Okay, so this is the trait race condition. Okay, let's read it actually. Race conditions in threading C sharp. Okay.
Introduction. A race condition occurs when two or more threads are able to access shared data and they try to change it at the same time. Because the thread scheduling algorithm can swap between threads at any point, we cannot know the order at which the threads will attempt to access the shared data. Therefore, the result of the change in data is dependent on the thread scheduling algorithm, i.e., both threads are racing to access/change the data. The reason for having more race conditions among threads than processes is that threads can share their memory while a process cannot. For example, let's say we have two threads, T1 and T2, where both are accessing a shared variable x. They first read data from the variable and then try to write data on the variable simultaneously. They would race to find which of these threads can write the value last to the variable. In this case, the last written value would be saved. As another example, we can have these two threads, T1 and T2, trying opposite operations on this variable. Let thread T1 increase the value of the variable, and the thread T2 decrease the value of the variable at the same point of time. What is the result? The value remains unchanged.
Okay, so you see the issue here is, let me explain to you. Let's say we have four threads, right? Thread A, okay, so let's me write it. So let's say thread A or thread one access the variable, read it as 2000, increase by 1, and save. So at the same time, thread 2 access the variable, read it as 2000, increase by 1, and save. So thread 1 saves first and it becomes 2001, but at the same time, red two saves and it becomes 2001 again instead of becoming 2002. So how can we prevent that? We need to use luck. With luck, only a single thread can access to that element at a time. Okay, so how we are going to do it? Let me show you. First, I will set the value of our variable to zero here. Okay. Then I will use the same. I will use another method with luck. Increase number with synchronization. Okay, let me check. Find the correct spelling. Oh, I did write it correctly. Wow. Okay. And to be this able to work, we need another object, or we can just call luck, but I will show you the proper way. So it can be either like this, luck db count, or oh, this is not luckable because it is not a reference type, therefore we need a reference type. Okay, private static object, we use object. Because the object is the smallest reference type, lock double, and we need to initialize it as new object. Okay, and we will lock it. We will lock the double whenever we are going to increase its value. Okay, and we can make it like this. Okay. And now I will use the synchronization for. Okay. This time we are calling synchronization. Okay, synchronization having method with using luck. Okay, and this time even I will call more threads at the same time, and let's see what do we get. Okay, the expected value is 80,000, and what we got, what we are going to get actually, of course locking is resourceful, what I mean is it is consuming resources, so it slows down your application a bit. Okay, this time we have got zero. And why? This is interesting. This is definitely not what should we get. Okay, let's see. Oh, I know the reason. I know the reason. Okay. So, what was the reason, do you think? We made that same mistake here as well. These tasks are executed immediately. Therefore, when we read the value here, they are still being executed. So I also need to wait started tasks. And how am I going to do that? I'm going to do it with, okay, let's write it here. Okay, when we read the data here, the tasks are still being executed. Therefore, we are not getting the final Valia. So we need to be sure that tasks are completed. And how we are going to do that? We are going to do it with list. By the way, to be able to list, I need to add another reference, which is collections generic tasks. And LST started tasks equal to new tasks. Okay, what I am going to do is where we are task. When you start a task with start new, it returns an awaitable task. And I will just add that task to here. We are task. Okay. Then I am going to call LST tasks and then wait all. I think to be able to do that, we had something else. Task collection or something. Okay, how do we do it? Find, let's see. Okay, there is, yeah, task wait all. Okay, now I remember. So then we use task dot wait all, and wait all takes, you see, task array, which is our LST started tasks. And we need to convert it to array. Okay. Now, the application will wait all tasks to get finish it. However, this is still not preventing data race. Okay. And now we need to do same for other tasks as well. So we are going to edit here too. Okay. And then we will call the same. The previous tasks are finished, therefore these won't using the same list will not affect our performance or anything. And let's see the results. Okay, this time we have got 60,000. And the data race didn't happen with double. Actually, this is kind of not expected. Maybe we should run without debugging. Yes. So with debugging, it was slow enough to increase all values independently. However, when we run the application without debugging, you see it becomes faster, but still not precise. So let's increase our task count, number of tasks count, and let's see what do we get. Oh, we are supposed to get 100,000 right now. And what do we get? Okay, now it is. There are more tasks than it can handle. Therefore, we are getting only this. However, with the locking approach, we are getting always 80,000. We can even increase number of tasks, something very high, like 20. And we are supposed to get 22,000. And here, let's make it 20. And we are supposed to get 200,000. Of course, this will make application using more CPU. But still calculating too fast. Wow. Oh, we are still getting all value. So let's run without debugging. Okay. And we got this. But each time we will always get 200,000. All right. So when you are working with multitasking, you always have to synchronize between threads. You always have to have synchronization between threads. Okay. This is a very important rule. Never forget that. Without synchronization between threads, you will not get deterministic results. Okay. If these were, there is also another way. And if these were not a double, and let's say if this was a static long, and IR long like this, zero, I could synchronize this without any locking. How could I do that? I could do it with interlocked. Okay, by the way, interlocked also requires threading like this. And we have added threading, as you can see. And interlocked, and then there is increment. So this is thread safe operation. And as long as you use interlocked for everything, it will become thread safe. You see, provides atomic operations for variables that are shared by multiple threads. Atomic means it will happen in a cycle. Okay, so what does atomic operation mean? It means it will be happening in a single CPU cycle, if I remember correctly.
An atom is indivisible. Atomic operations are indivisible operations, which cannot be divided, example, interrupted. Microprocessors do not execute sequentially, that is, instruction after instruction, just like written in a program. There are external objects, which can change execution flow. A good example are interrupts. So, you may know the MOV instruction, which is available on pretty much all processors. Imagine that it is executed by the CPU. A 32-bit value is moved into a 32-bit register. Now, after 16 bits have been moved, an interrupt request occurs. An atomic MOV instruction will not stop, but will execute to the end, and then the CPU will handle the interrupt. A MOV instruction that is not atomic will immediately be stopped and the interrupt is executed. The problem is, if the interrupt accessed the register, which was written to by the MOV, the content is unclear because the MOV operation is only half finished. Now, on usual processors, MOVs operating on the processor's word size are atomic. If a processor word is 16 bits wide, a 16-bit MOV instruction will be atomic. However, a 32-bit MOV operation would not be atomic. Such a non-atomic MOV instruction is normally not provided by the instruction set, but by some higher-level language as with C's long-long or C-sharp S-long. Operations on these data types are not guaranteed to be atomic.
Okay, so you understand the issue. Since we are incrementing a double, which is 64 bit, if I remember correctly, let's see, double, or let's say C-sharp double bit size. Oh, it's 8 bytes, which means it is 64 bit, yeah. Therefore, it will take two operations in a 30 bit application. Okay, and it won't be atomic, never. And to be sure that your operation is atomic, you have to use increment. This will make it atomic programmatically. It can take ref, and it can take long or int 32. Now it will increment it by one. You can also set how much increments Each of these all increments by one. There is also add or other functions you see, such as add. With add, you can add any value you want, like this. And this will be atomic. Okay, so let's put it to here and see what value we are going to get. So we will get 10,000, 20,000. And okay. Let's write it here. Expected value of long with atomic, let's say, or auto or interlocked. Okay. And the value we get is IR long. Let's see what it is. So even though we are not doing any synchronization with lock, it should be always 220,000, and yes, it is like that. You see, double is not like that, but the interlocked is like that. So this is also another way. If you are working with integers or longs, then use interlocked. This can be used for reading or many other things. Let's see. So it supports add, increment, exchange, or decrement. Okay. With add, you can also use subtract with negative values, and exchange means it exchange values. It sets a value to something. Okay. So this is thread safe. Okay, so let's take notes of this as well. Okay. What is yield return and how to use yield return? Okay. Yield return example. Okay, what is data raising when working with multi tasking? Okay. How to prevent data raising with synchronization between threads by using lock methodology? Okay. How can we use interlocked to ensure our operations on int32 or long int64 variables are thread safe? Okay. How to achieve its safety when working with multiple threads tasks. Okay. And anything else we related to threads? Okay, so in this case, it is not throwing an error. However, if we were working with lists, such as adding lists or enumerating lists and doing another thing with that list, meanwhile in another application, another thread, that could cause our application to, let's say, our application to crash because of an uncaught error. And yes, okay. Next semester, of course, we will see more things related to multi-threading, other things. If you have specific questions or topics that you want to see, please contact me, or you can also comment to the video. So at next lecture, I can show you that. At the next lecture, I am planning to write a crawler, a simple web crawler to do more multitasking operation and other operations. And okay, so we are pretty much done. We have shown a lot of things. Okay, and I think I will finish it here for this week. And all right, let's upload our source code to the GitHub. I didn't do other screens of the patient management system because they would be same as drugs panel. You could use other features such as combo boxes, text boxes, you already know them, list boxes. They all work same methodology, with same methodology. Okay. Okay, end of lecture 10. Hopefully see you next week.